Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Jaya Prabhupada, Jaya Prabhupada, Jaya Prabhupada, Jaya Prabhupada, Prabhupada, Jaya 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 Gurudev, 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 Jaya Gurudev. Nitai Gaura Hari Bol, Hari Hari Bol, Gaur Hari Bol.
Jai Om Vishnupada Paramahansa Parivrajakacharya Ashtotara Shatashri Srimad Divine Grace Abhay Charanarvinda Bhakti Vedanta Swami Maharaj Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Jai Om Vishnupada Paramahansa Parivrajakacharya Ashtotara Shatashri Srimad His Divine Grace Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Goswami Thakur Prabhupada Ki Jai. Ananta Koti Vaishnavrinda Ki Jai. Granthraj Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Jai. Nithai Gaura Premanandi. All glories to assembled devotees. All glories to assembled devotees. All glories to assembled devotees, all glories, all glories, all glories to Sri Guru and Sri Gauranga. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Today we are continuing our reading from Srimad Bhagavatam. This is Canto 11, Chapter 28, Text Number 11. Atma Vayo, Atma Vyayo, Agunaha, Shuddha, Swayam, Jyoti, Anavrittaha, Agnivad, Daruvad, Achid, Deha, Kasseha, Samstruti, Atma Vyayoguna Shuddha, Swayam Jyotiranavritaha, Agnivad Daruvad Achid Deha Kasseha Samshruti Atma Vyayo Guna Shuddha Swayam Jyotiranavritaha Agnivad Daruvad Achid Deha kasteha samshruti आत्मा व्ययो गुणशुद्धः स्वयं ज्योतिरनावृतः अग्निवद् दारुवद् अचेद् देह कस्येह संश्रुतिः word to word meaning atma the spirit soul avyaya inexhaustible aguna transcendental to the material modes shuddha pure svayam jyoti self luminous anavritah uncovered agnivat like fire daruvat like firewood achit non living deha the material body kasya of which iha in this world samshrutihi the experience of material life Translation purport by the disciples of His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada Ki Jaya. Translation: The spirit soul is inexhaustible, transcendental, pure, self-luminous and never covered by anything material. It is like fire, but the non-living material body, like firewood, is dull and unaware. So in this world, who is that actually undergoes the experience of material life? Purport. The word anavritta and agnivat are significant here. Fire can never be covered with darkness because by nature fire is illuminating. Similarly, the spirit soul is Swayam Jyoti or self-luminous, and thus the soul is transcendental. He can never be covered by darkness of material life. On the other hand, the material body like firewood is by nature dull and unilluminated. In itself, it does not have any awareness of life. If the soul is transcendental to material life, and the body is not even conscious of it, the following question arises: how does our experience of material existence actually take place? Om Jnanati Mirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Utapada Kamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamsha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam, Savadutam, Parijana Sahitam, Krishna Chaitanya Devam, Shri Radha Krishna Padan, Sahagana Lalita, Sri Vishakan Vitamsha, Nama Om Vishnu Padaya, Krishna Prashtaya Bhutale, Srimate Bhakti Vedanta, Swamin Itinamine,
Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarine Namo Mahavadanyaya Krishna Prema Pradayate Krishnaya Krishna Chaitanya Namine Gauratvishe Namaha He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dinabandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jaya Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare 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 Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare
Atma Vyayo Gunashudho Gunashuddha Swayam Jyotir Anavritaha Agnivad Daruvad Achid Deha Kasyaha Samshrutihi. The spirit soul is inexhaustible, transcendental, pure, self-luminous and never covered by anything material. It is like fire, but the non-living material body like firewood is dull and unaware. So in this world, who is that actually undergoes the experience of material life? Hare Krishna, welcome all the devotees for today's Sunday morning Bhagavatam class. We are continuing our discussion from Uddhava Gita, where Uddhava is here again asking a question to Lord Sri Krishna. So a brief background of this message of Uddhava Gita, which we are reading for many, many months now. It's quite amazing. Uddhava is asking question to Krishna. The glory of Uddhava is like this, that Uddhava is known as the famous disciple of Brihaspati. Brihaspati is the spiritual master of all the demigods. And he is one of the favorite disciples of Brihaspati. So he is well known to be a very jnani or a very knowledgeable person. And to his credit, he is in Dwarka. And externally seen, it is mentioned that when Krishna is in this courtroom of Dwarka, and if there any problem arises which no one has any solution, then Krishna always refers that problem to Uddhava to seek his solution. So he is one sense the counsel of even Krishna for many matters. Uddhava also was sent by Lord Krishna to the land of Vrindavan to give consolation to the gopis. So in his cap there are a lot of feathers, and all the feathers are relevant to the item of knowledge. So Uddhava is one who is known for his great knowledge. In fact, after this Uddhava Gita, Krishna is going to send Uddhava to Badrikashram to give his message to the devotees in Badrikashram. Nonetheless, here we can see that Uddhava is eager to know more and more. That is an amazing quality of Uddhava, which is seen in this whole Uddhava Gita. That in spite of all that great knowledge which he possesses, still he is in the mood of knowing more. Like a student asking more and more questions. Why? Because he is interested in hearing again and again, maybe the same subject matter. So, here, the whole idea is, we can see Uddhava is asking a question here. This whole chapter, which is entitled Jnana Yoga, is nothing but the summary of whatever so far Krishna has given pertaining to the section of knowledge.
Now we are coming towards the end of the Uddhava Gita section. After this will be another chapter called as Bhakti Yoga, and therein then Uddhava Gita is completed, and just 2-3 more chapters are remaining for this 11th canto to get over. So almost like 13 to 14 chapters of Uddhava Gita, and we can see here that Uddhava is even now eager to know more, and Krishna is summarizing the whole thing. So this eagerness to know more is a divine quality. We see throughout the Bhagavatam pages so many great devotees. They were not agyanis. They were not dullards or they did not know anything. They were not like people who come to the temple and then we have this Gita course or self journey of self-discovery course, and you tell them that we are not this body, we are spirit soul, right? But in spite of that, such query is even asked by Uddhava, which shows that eagerness to know is a quality of attracting Krishna. We see in Bhagavatam, Devahuti Mata, mother of Kapila Dev. She is the mother of Kapila Dev. No one can become mother of Supreme Personality of Godhead unless they have enough spiritual credits to their bank account. And yet she is taking all the opportunity to ask questions to his son, to her son Kapila Muni. In fact, Srila Prabhupada mentions in one of the purports that Devahuti is already satisfied with whatever explanation Kapila Muni has given already to her. But still she's asking more because she wants to know more and more, and she does not want to lose the opportunity, such a wonderful opportunity to ask and hear from her own son, who is Supreme Lord Himself. And in Bhagavatam also we find the example of Vidura. Vidura is none other than Yamraj, one of the great Mahajans. But now Vidura is here, and he is known as the famous advisor of the whole Kuru dynasty. Even Bhishma Dev takes advice from him. He is a son and disciple of Vyasadev. And still Vidura, when he is on a pilgrimage, when he leaves the Kuru dynasty, when he goes out of his palace, he is travelling on all the holy places and he hears from all great saintly rishis. And then he meets Uddhava in Vrindavan and is eager to know from him. So much of his eagerness that Uddhava, Vidura is not just asking one question, he is asking questions after questions after question. It's like, you know, sometimes you are fasting for a long time, then you become very eager to eat. And in the anticipation of eating, you take more than what is required. The whole plate is full. That's our problem. But Uddhava doesn't have such problem. He doesn't have problem of hearing too much. Vidura of hearing too much. So Vidura is asking so many questions. In fact, one of the qualities of Vidura, we can see that when he is asking questions later to Maitri Rishi, there is one chapter full of questions. Can you imagine a chapter of 34, 40 verses full of questions? This shows Vidura's eagerness. Even though he is a well-known personality of advising great people, but yet he is also playing the role of a student, wanting to know more. So this is a quality which every devotee must imbibe in their life. There is never enough for one to hear. We should, as a devotee progresses in spiritual life, his jigyasa, his capacity to hear and ask questions should increase. That's what we see from Bhagavatam here. I would like to narrate a story from Katha Upanishad today, a very beautiful story. This is a story of Nachiket. So there was once a great sage, Vajashravasa. He was a great Brahmana and he would regularly perform rituals and yagyas. One day he decided that he wanted to get some divine gifts from the demigods. So he began a great ritual. And in the ritual, he decided to offer whatever possession he has to the demigods. So to show that he's offering that possession, he decided to offer the possession in the form of cows which he had. So he was offering all that cows, mentioning that, okay, this Indra, take this cow. So he had many cows. Indra, take this cow. Chandra, please take this cow. So all the mantras he was chanting with, giving one cow after another. He had a son, young son, Nachiket, who was also taking training in his rituals. And he was visualizing the whole thing, analyzing. And he found something mysterious. He saw that his father was doing rituals and is offering possessions to the demigod in the form of cows. But his father was offering only those cows who were old cows, non-milking cows, and cows which have bodily disabilities. So he was not happy with what father was doing. So he wanted to do something so that father, because he was thinking if father offers such kind of donations, then he will return also get something which is also very compromising gifts. He will not get actual things which he is wanting to. So Nachiket was thinking how to speak this to my father, you know. So in a very sarcastic way, in a very humorous way, he asked father, "Father, you are offering all your possessions. I am also your possession. To which god you'll offer me?" So the father was annoyed by this question. So but he continued the ritual. But Nachiket again asked the same question. "My dear father, you are offering all your possessions. I am also your possession, your son. To whom you are going to offer me?" So in a bit of rage, sage Vajashravasa, he said, "Okay, I offer you to Yamraj, the god of death." So these are times when people had power. And so he said, "Okay, I am offered to Yamraj. Let me go to Yamraj and serve him." So Nachiket immediately descended, or ascended, whatever, wherever he goes, go to Yamraj, you know, Yama's abode. And when he went to Yama's abode, somehow that Yamraj was not there. Maybe he had gone on special duty, you know. Like today, everyone is, the police force is on special duty throughout the streets of India. So you are also on a special duty. So it took 3 days for Yamraj to come back to his abode. He was waiting eagerly to meet Yamraj. And Yamraj saw him. "Hey, why you come here?" And he told the whole story. And Yamraj said, "I am really appreciating your greatness that you, without hospitality, you waited for me for 3 days. So I want to offer you 3 boons. Ask for 3 boons from me." Yamraj asked Nachiket. So Nachiket's intelligence has to be now examined properly. It is said Nachiket was wanting to ask the ultimate. But he did not ask directly, because he thought if I ask directly something very great from Yamraj, maybe he will think twice and not offer me. So he went gradually. So he said, "Well, thank you Yamraji for 3 boons. The first boon I want to ask is, let there be peace, shanti, for my father and myself when I return home back to my father." So Yamraj said, "Oh, it's a very small thing. Done, given." So what is the next boon you want to ask? The next boon is, "I wish to learn a very special yagya from you, by which, doing this yagya, one can reach the ultimate destination, spiritual world." So Yamraj said, "I can teach you yagya." Okay, then Yamraj taught him a yagya, a new yagya, by which, you know, he could do the yagya and reach ultimate destination. And Yamraj was so pleased by his determination, his disciplined nature, and his humility, that after teaching the yagya, all the details of the yagya, Yamraj said to Nachiket that, you know, because you made me teach this yagya will be renamed now, and this yagya will be called as Nachiket Yagya henceforward. So in this way, slowly Nachiket was kind of, you know, very much winning the heart of Yamraj. And now came the main question for which he was waiting. He said, "What is the last one?" "The last boon I want to ask is very simple. I have heard that the Supreme Personality of Godhead, he is very mysterious. It's very difficult to know him. He is the controller of everything. He is the cause of all causes. He is mystery for everyone. Kindly resolve this mystery to me. Explain to me who is Supreme Personality of Godhead." Now this subject itself is a big subject matter, right? It's like someone asking you, "Tell me something about how to do Abhishek in Janmashtami." Now, if he doesn't know anything, you will have to tell him everything what is Abhishek. And that will take, this question looks like a very simple question, but this question itself is a subject matter, right? Like many times we give Bhagavatam class and someone asks a very question which is itself a Bhagavatam class. So we will tell them, I think so we can discuss later, because if I answer that question, that will be another half an hour. So this question was very loaded question. Why? Because this question was in general asking about Krishna, asking about Supreme Personality of Godhead. So Yamaraj was very confused. He was mentioning that, he mentioned to him, Nachiket, the boon you asked me to explain the mystery of Supreme Personality of Godhead, that is even difficult for demigods to understand. And yet you are asking me this difficult question, but I am still pleased with you. Nachiket told Yamaraj that whatever so far I have asked, it looks more or less temporary, but this is a permanent thing which I want to ask from you. And therefore, without this boon, all other boons are temporary, all other boons are useless. Then Yamaraj became very happy, because by the time Nachiket had won his heart, and Yamaraj spoke to him great details about the knowledge of absolute truth and enlightened him in Krishna consciousness. So this particular story is mentioned in the Upanishad to give us an understanding of how eager one should be to get knowledge about Krishna. Like in the outside world, there's hook or crook, right? People earn money. In Krishna consciousness, it's not hook or crook, but somehow or other, yena kena prakarena, we have to be always eager to know about Krishna. And for that, anything is okay. You need any technique, any tactics, because to get benefit from devotees' association is not very easy, because devotee by nature is humble. They don't speak out. But you'll have to approach devotee in such a way that finally the details will come out from him and he will be eager to explain to you. Like for example, eagerness of Krishna, eagerness of Arjuna. Arjuna had so many questions in the first chapter of Bhagavad Gita, and Krishna wrapped up the whole questions in one chapter, second chapter, all the answers given. But Arjuna was not satisfied. He wanted to hear more, and to make him understand more, the eagerness for his, Krishna explained all third chapter, fourth chapter. In every chapter, more or less, Arjuna asking more questions. Even in 18th chapter, Arjuna is asking questions. This is called as an eagerness of a devotee to understand more and more. So here we can see this eagerness in Uddhava's life, right? Uddhava is a disciple of Brihaspati, as we mentioned. But just imagine what eagerness he has got. Throughout this whole series of chapter in Uddhava Gita, let's analyze what all Uddhava has asked, what all chapters have gone through for Krishna to relate and answer to Uddhava. Coming back to Uddhava's question, Krishna has answered Uddhava on the nature of what is Karmakand. Uddhava's question, Krishna has answered on Vairagya and detachment. So to understand Uddhava's question, to relate to that, Krishna has explained the yoga system. Then Krishna also explained Varnashram system. Krishna also explained in details pure bhakti, pure devotional service. Krishna also explained Sankhya Yoga. Then just recently, last chapter, Krishna explained the Kriya Yoga, the deity worship. And now, in summary style, Krishna is explaining Jnana Yoga, and the next chapter Krishna explains in briefly Bhakti Yoga. So Uddhava's eagerness to know has led to the discussion on all these various topics in the Uddhava Gita. So we can see Uddhava is teaching an example to all the devotees of how eager we should know about Krishna. Not just some very esoteric knowledge of Krishna, but even that knowledge which pertains to his creation and other systems of philosophy as well, to get a clear understanding, right? Like Ishvarupanishad mentions, one needs to know Vidya, Avidya, and also so-called Vidya. So a devotee needs to know everything so that he can follow the path of Krishna consciousness properly. So here in this particular verse, these two verses, yesterday's verse and today's verse, Uddhava is again asking a question. Now before we take this question, I would like to present an understanding of what this questioning is all about. In this material world, asking a question is actually seen not with right attitude. People see a person asking question with a kind of a very wrong attitude. I remember when I was in school, and teachers would come in different classes and they would teach. And invariably in every classroom, you must have also experienced, there would be few students who would always ask questions, right? Few of them, two, three of them. And every time they would raise the hands, I would see my friends around me would discuss. Again he's asking a question. And the conclusion of everyone, most of the people in class would be that either he did not understand, itna buddhu hai, or second, maybe he wants to show off what knowledge he has got. So just imagine our education system has trained us such a way that if we even think of asking a question, we are very much conscious what people think about us. People think that he wants to show off. People may think, oh, that he has not understood anything. And that is the reason the questioning attitude has gone down. I remember many times I had question to ask to my teacher, but I would filter that, you know, I would start thinking, if I ask question, what will happen is, immediately after the period would get over, the class would get over, my friends would say, haan, bada scholar ban raha hai. So out of the fear, I would not ask questions. So questioning is something which is seen very like a derogative thing in the material world. But in Krishna consciousness, to ask question is a sign of progress, is a sign of intelligence. So, we can see here that in the Srimad Bhagavatam, almost similar kind of questions have been asked by great devotees. It is not that they were not knowing subject matter. It is not like what kind of question Uddhava is going to ask today. He had never heard about it and never came across it. But he's asking the same question because he wants to know more details about the same question, get answers about it. So Bhagavatam is full of like that information. The whole idea is Krishna consciousness, spiritual life trains us to understand that we don't know anything. And when we know that we don't know anything, then we are ready to know everything. Because then we'll approach. Tadvidhi pranipatena pariprashnena sevaya. So part of spiritual life is tadvidhi pranipat. Surrender to Guru and pariprashna. Ask questions. Pariprashnena tadvidhi pranipatena pariprashnena sevaya. Upadyakshanti te jnanam jnaninas tattva darshina. It is well known in the spiritual circles that a guru will speak, but he will not give details till the person who is hearing or people who are hearing are eager for the details. We find many places Parikshit Maharaj, Sukhdev Goswami also trying to wind up many pastimes till Parikshit Maharaj inquires, please tell me in details about that, and then the whole pastime opens up, right? So this is how spiritual life or spiritual circles work like that. So the whole idea is to ask questions for our benefit, and when you ask questions, that also benefit everyone. Therefore, Vedanta Sutra mentions, Athato Brahma Jigyasa. So Jigyasa is part of human life, to ask, to inquire. Bhagavatam also, whenever Parikshit Maharaj is asking question, or the sages of Naimisharanya asking questions, and both the speakers, they glorify the person who is asking question. Varyan esate prashna krito loka hitam. This prashna, this question about Supreme Absolute Truth is beneficial for everyone, loka hitam. So with this background we can see, what is the loka hitam in Uddhava asking this question? A very simple question Uddhava is asking here to Krishna in his two verses. Krishna's soul, the spirit soul, is pure, is unaffected, part and parcel of Krishna. On the other hand, the body is inert, unconscious. So soul is pure, unaffected, and body is not conscious. So now his question is, then this illusion is experienced by whom? Is perceived by whom in this material world? If soul is pure, body is inert, not active, who perceives this illusion, right? It's a very amazing question, because you see, this question brings out the idea of the bondage of the soul in this material world, which is a very important matter, because every soul in this material world is in the bondage, and the solution is to come out of the bondage. So this one question is leading a thread to many discussions about how one can escape from cycle of birth and escape from the illusion. Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, Mama Maya Duratyaya. This illusion of mine is very difficult to overcome. So Uddhava is asking a question, actually question asking is question on the behalf of all the audience, that how a pure spirit soul has come in contact in this material world and undergone illusion even though it's pure. So here we can see that we need to know the power of illusion. So Uddhava is experiencing or asking how powerful is this illusory energy of the Lord. Now, we would not dwell into the answer of this question because the answer is coming now soon. Krishna is going to answer. But let's take this part of this word illusion mentioned here. That how does a spirit soul come under illusion? Well, Srila Prabhupada mentions in many of his scriptures that this illusion is perceived as real when you are in an unreal situation. And what is the unreal situation? When a spirit soul falls from knowledge into ignorance. Srila Prabhupada gave many analogies to understand this. One of the brilliant analogies Srila Prabhupada gives for any living entity in this world who is conditioned to understand, the example of a dream. Right? To understand something which is beyond us, we need an example from this world. So Prabhupada gave many times to make the understand the concept of illusion by explaining illusion to be like a dream. Now we have seen many dreams in our sleep time, right? When we sleep. So we can understand what it is dream. Prabhupada said, just like someone is dreaming. And then he sees that someone has cut his head. And Prabhupada says, how can one see when someone's head is cut? Right? Eyes are in the head. Head is cut, he cannot see. That is illusion. He sees his head is cut and he's struggling, he's shouting, please save me, my head is cut. And someone wakes him. Then he cuts up. Oh, my head is intact. So that experience in that dream of head being cut is illusion. Then Prabhupada gives another example. Tiger is chasing. Someone sees a dream when tiger is chasing and then he's experiencing that whole thing, you know. Even he's sweating in the dream and he's running and finally cries out, bachao, help me. And someone wakes him, what happened? Then he's happy. Tiger is not chasing. So tiger is real, but the seeing the tiger in the dream is not real. But the experience of seeing an illusion in the dream is real because reality perspiration has come. So that is how illusion is powerful. Then we see in our life also so many times we see dreams, right? When we see good dreams, what happens? When we see good dreams and someone wakes us up, we become very sad. Kya yaar achha dream tha, uta diya mereko. But when we see bad dreams, someone wakes us up or we wake up, we are very happy. Bad dream is over, right? So even dreams also, our situation is good dream, we feel bad. Bad dream, we feel good. So this is the power of illusion. Srila Prabhupada gave wonderful examples of dreams to experience, to give us an idea of what this illusion, how it works. There's a story of one beggar who was sleeping in his hut, thatched hut, Jhopadi. And the night he dreamt. He dreamt that his thatched hut had become a big mansion, big palace. And he was living in the palace. And one gentleman came and he said, I want to purchase your palace. And then he said, okay, my palace is worth 100 lakh rupees, the beggar said, in a dream. And the gentleman, the wealthy man who had come to ask for money or ask for the palace, said, well, that's too costly. I can only give you 80 lakhs. So no, 100 lakhs. So no, 80 lakhs. So there was an argument going on, 100 lakhs, 80 lakhs. And suddenly what happened? A big pot which was there in the house, due to a rat running around, fell down, dam, in the hut. And the beggar woke up and he realized, hey, that was a dream. So he became very unhappy. Immediately closed his eyes in order to recollect the whole dream, you know. He closed his eyes and said, okay, no problem, 80 lakhs is enough, give me. So this is our position. We try to enter into dream, we are happy with our dreams, But ultimately it's a dream. There is no benefit of the dream, no gain. Only some emotions are churned, that's it. Like, I remember one time I was traveling to one place, temple, and I was staying there, and they asked me to give 2-3 Bhagavatam class daily, you know, every day. So there were many devotees sitting in the class, and there's one old devotee, and the first day when I gave a class, he asked me a question. Prabhu, he said, Prabhuji, Prabhupada came in my dream yesterday, and he told me this. So initially I was very fascinated. Prabhupada came in his dream. I answered him like this. You are so fortunate. Prabhupada came in his dream. And he said, in my dream horrible things come, you know. So you are very fortunate. So I am kind of encouraged, very nice, no problem. And gave him some answer. The next day he asked a question. Prabhupada came in my dream again last night. Then I understand there is some issue there. You know? Prabhupada is regularly coming in this devotee's dream, you know. So finally, after third day, after getting enough information about this devotee, and third day when he asked me a question, Prabhupada came in my dream. I said, very nice, so beautiful. Then asked, Prabhupada said so many things. We should cross-check also about what Prabhupada is saying, is it not? And I said, thank you very much. You're asking this question to me that Prabhupada came in your dream and told you this. You're a very humble person. You did not keep the dream with yourself and started executing the dream. At least you're asking a question about the dream. So we need to cross-check also Prabhupada's dream. So he said, how should we cross-check, he asked. He said, we should cross-check by, see, Prabhupada is speaking in dream, right? So Prabhupada also has spoken in other places. So where Prabhupada has spoken? Prabhupada has spoken in books. So Prabhupada is speaking in dream, you check with Prabhupada also has spoken in the books. Read books. And Prabhupada speaking in dream, Prabhupada spoken in books, the same. Very good. You follow the dream. Then he understood, oh yes. So the point is, such kinds of dreams come. One time Srila Prabhupada was giving a lecture, he mentioned, one devotee asked me, Prabhupada, I got your dream. And in dream, Prabhupada, you came and said, do not chant Hare Krishna. So Prabhupada told him, that was Maya who came in form of me. And told him, not chant Hare Krishna. So dreams can be good, sometimes very enlightening, but dream also needs a cross-checking. Whether those dreams are relevant for us. Can we follow those dreams in our life? So, Prabhupada used the example of dream to drive in the concept of illusion, which Uddhava is asking here. So, this illusion can be overcome with the help of the person who has generated this illusion. Right? Krishna says, in the scripture we see in Chaitanya Charitam, Krishna Surya Sama Maya Hoy Andhakar, Jaha Krishna Taha Nai Maya Radhikar. So, when there is Krishna is there is knowledge, light. There is no darkness. There is no illusion. When Krishna is not there, there is darkness, there is illusion. So presence of Krishna is no illusion. Absence of Krishna is illusion. So therefore, our illusion can be driven away when Krishna is present. So how Krishna comes? Krishna comes in various ways. Krishna himself comes. Krishna comes in the form of devotees. Or Krishna also comes as enlighten us in the form of situations in our life. Okay? Now Krishna comes himself. Now Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he came to drive away illusion. The beautiful song of Bhaktivinoda Thakur, you know. Jiva jago, jiva jago, gaura chandra bole, koto nidra jao maya, pishachira kole. Wake up sleeping souls, you are sleeping in the lap of illusion, maya. Wake up, I have come to wake you up, O Lord. Oh my dear spirit souls. So Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is bringing the whole Sankirtan Andolan movement to wake us up all us from the illusion of this material world. We all are in this material world in illusion of our own. We are like a, you know, we have seen the horses when the tanga wala, they drive the horse, or the horse, the person who is driving the horse, riding the horse, he puts some blinders on the horse, right? Why they put blinders on the horse? Because the horse has a tendency to look here and there and get distracted. So they put blinders so the horse can see in the front only and keep walking one way, straight. And only when the rider pulls the right on the right side, then he takes a right turn. Similarly, in our illusory existence, we are very narrow-minded. We are only pursuing one path. We are not concerned about the world or what others, me and my life. But Krishna comes to remove that illusion from our life. Either he comes himself His teachings are there, devotees come in our life, our situation comes, right? So, like for example, this beautiful shloka which comes in 11th Bhagavat, 11th Canto. Maya Mrigam Anvadhavat. Vande Mahapurushate Charanarvindam. So this shloka refers to Lord Ram, Lord Shri Krishna and Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So when it refers to Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Maya Mrigam means Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu took sannyas to run after people who are in illusion and bring them to Krishna consciousness. Chaitanya Mangal mentions Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu telling to Narad Muni that I will run after the living entities who are in illusion, and some of these living entities will run away from this place and will go to some other places. So he was referring to some other places, means out of Bharata, out of land of India, other places. And Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu tells Narad Muni, that time I will send my commander-in-chief, Senapati Bhakta, to go and preach to them there also. So this is Krishna's plan to drive away our illusion. So devotees come, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Lord Krishna comes to drive away our illusion. So Chaitanya Charitamrita is full of such wonderful shlokas about how Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Krishna's Kaviraj Goswami in general is speaking about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's contribution of driving our illusion. So as I was mentioning initially that this illusion is very strong, very powerful, and very difficult for ourselves to come out of illusion. So therefore we see from the pages of Srimad Bhagavatam as well that great devotees are teaching us to inquire about how to overcome illusion, and also discussions on illusion of how to overcome takes place between great devotees. So mentioned about how Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, Mama Maya Duratyaya, my illusion is difficult to overcome. We also see in the Shastra that in the beginning of 11th Canto, Vasudev is asking question to Narad Muni. And what is his question? His question is, how much powerful is his attachment? Please let me know how to overcome it. Who is asking this question to Narad Muni? Vasudev. Vasudev, who is the father of Lord Krishna himself, he is asking question. Then you find discussion of when Nanda Maharaj visits Vasudev, when Krishna is born, he comes to pay taxes to Kamsa. And there is a discussion between Vasudev and Nanda Maharaj. In that discussion, they are discussing how powerful is the attachment, how powerful is illusion. So he said even great devotees are discussing about illusion and how to overcome illusion. Markandeya Rishi, he was so pure, he wanted to know what is his illusion. So he asked Krishna, please show me a glimpse of your illusion. So Krishna gave him a good glimpse, you know. 7 days of Brahma, he was put in illusion. Pralaya Sagar, he was floating in the Pralaya Sagar, he was watching alligators, big Timingala fish, but they were not eating him. So he was getting all the experience of what fear is all about, but he was not killed, he did not die. And after that whole experience, then he understood, oh, what is illusion? This all is coming from Krishna, like he entered into Krishna's mouth, so all the illusion Krishna put him out, again he came back in the same place. And that too in a moment time, not that he had to wait, Krishna had to wait for 7 days of Brahma. So you find in scriptures also, many devotees, they are discussing about illusion, so that conditioned soul refers scriptures and understand how even to understand the power of illusion is important in Krishna consciousness. So, I was talking about Krishna comes himself and devotees also come to drive our illusion. Now there is another way by how Krishna drives away our illusion. And that is by creating a situation of crisis in our life. In this way, Krishna shakes us from the normal life which we think is normal life. And that shaking up takes a great deal of crisis. Then, many times in the outside world we see everything's going so-called smooth and suddenly an accident happens or someone expires, a big tragedy, and people are jolted. The whole thing is like, they come out of the whole thing. The life will go like this normally. And suddenly the whole jolt comes and they realize. And then there is a chance of discussion of philosophy. People also become very philosophical, right? And said, life is temporary, everything is temporary. Of course, Prabhupada called such discussions are called smashan vairagya. They remain for some time, again back to square one. So in the life of a non-devotee, such a jolt makes them think about life. But because they have no association of devotees, that discussion or that thought remains for short time. The jolt or crisis in the life of a devotee helps the devotee to come into reality. What he has been learning so far in Krishna consciousness, now it is time to practice. Theory is over, now practical is comes. So jolt and crisis in a non-devotee life and a devotee life is also very important, because for a non-devotee is a chance to come to Krishna, for a devotee is a chance to become, to come more closer to Krishna, to appreciate Krishna's Krishna's intervening on our life. Krishna is intervening in our life. So there's an example. I'll take two examples before we close this class. Two examples from Shastra, where one who's not a devotee and one who's a devotee, they went through crisis. We'll take example of Chitraketu Maharaj. Chitraketu Maharaj is a great devotee. But in periods of Bhagavatam, when it begins, it is shown that he is an attached king. He has millions of wives. And all he wants is one son. Right? And finally, after perseverance, he asks from Angira Muni, he wants a son. Angira Muni wants him. He will get a son who will be a cause of jubilation and lamentation also. But no problem. In that message also, he thinks that lamentation, what lamentation will come? He will be a naughty child. He'll give me trouble, no problem. Blind uncle is better than no uncle. And there was no problem, give me a child. And then he gets a child, Harsha Shoka. And then what happens? Harsha Shoka dies. And then reality dawns upon Chitraketu Maharaj. But to his great credit, Angira Muni, Narad Muni come to help him. And then they wake up the child. And a child speaks philosophy. The parents, and after hearing the philosophy of what this material world is all temporary, and we are spirit soul, we are on a journey, we are going ahead in our life. And after hearing that philosophy, Chitraketu Maharaj undergoes transformation in life. And that transformation leads to his opening up a devotional career in his life. And then we see later the whole history of how Chitraketu Maharaj, he gets association of four Kumaras, then also he gets chance to meet Lord Shankarshan, and later Chitraketu Maharaj, to get special mercy, gets a curse from Parvati Devi, which he takes in a right spirit, and Chitraketu becomes a demon in the next life, Vritrasur, and then he goes back home, back to Godhead. So this is life of Chitraketu Maharaj. Crisis, he comes to Krishna conscious reality. We take same example of son dying. From Chaitanya Charitamrit, house of Srivas Thakur. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is having Sankirtan. Everyone is in great mood because Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is dancing. Srivas Thakur is also there, happy. And suddenly he hears some cry. He runs inside the house without any, and immediately sees that, you know, his wife and his other ladies in the house, they are crying because Srivas' only son has died. Immediately Srivas says, "Don't cry. If you cry, you will disturb the ecstasy of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And if you do so, then I will also jump in Ganga and commit suicide and die myself if you do so." When Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is dancing, there is nothing inauspicious. That is the power of the conviction of Srivas Thakur. But Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is dancing. He understands everything. He knows everything. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, "Why am I not feeling ecstasy? There is something inauspicious which has happened in this house." So you ask Srivas Thakur, what is that inauspiciousness which has happened in this house? And Srivas Thakur mentions, "What inauspiciousness? Oh Lord, you are dancing in our house. You are the most auspicious thing that is happening in our life. What more inauspicious can happen?" Then Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu asks Srivas Thakur, "Tell me." And then some devotees say, "Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Srivas Thakur's son has died." Then Mahaprabhu goes inside, you know, and all the ladies are wailing, but they are wailing in a very slow voice, you know. And Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu watches Srivas Thakur. So the conviction of Srivas Thakur. And Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu wakes up that child. And the child, he looks at Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and said, "Oh my Lord, life after life you are giving an opportunity to practice Krishna consciousness. Whatever you have destined for me in this body is all over now. Now I am going ahead in my journey as per your direction. thank you very much for whatever you have given me. He says that philosophical words and again he leaves his body, dies. And everyone is enlightened. All the crying stops. Right? And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu knows Srivas Thakur very well. He's a great devotee. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, Srivas Thakur, oh Srivas, you have lost one son. But take it from me. From today, you have now two sons. Lord Nityanand Prabhu and myself are your two sons. So when crisis comes in devotee's life, and when devotee recollect all the philosophical treatises which they have heard, that leads to double benefit. That leads to more realization of Krishna consciousness. So Srivas Thakur lost one son, but in turn he got two sons, Lord Chaitanya and Lord Nityananda. In fact, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself was thinking that how will I ever take sannyas if I devotees like Srivas who are so attached to me. So here is an example of life of a non-devotee and life of a devotee in crisis coming. I was just analyzing the situation now. The big illusion has now been bursted, the bubble of illusion, right now in the crisis of this pandemic of coronavirus, right? And it is applicable to both the devotees and non-devotees. Like devotees can't say this corona will not affect me, and non-devotees can't say corona will not affect. Everyone is, everywhere around the world, there is fear factor. So this is one way of Krishna bursting the bubble of illusion. And what is the result? The result is people are now thinking some other things also, which they were never thinking in their life because of that blinder, narrow-mindedness. People are now, because the time is there, the quarantine or that, lockdown is there, everyone is inside and they have some time to think. Yesterday I called a mother and she was mentioning that in our building, many people never came to temple, you know. Never were also interested in Krishna consciousness, but I see everyone is watching Ramayana and Mahabharata now. It's amazing, you know. People are becoming more spiritual minded because that fear factor is there. Spiritual, what will happen? Because the uncertainty factor is there. More, right? More fear factor is there. And now people have started appreciating nature, right? People are sending good messages on how nature is. Like yesterday someone sent me a message that someone in Jalandhar, people are taking photographs of first time ever in their life watching the Himalayan mountains in the sky. 200 kilometers from Jalandhar are the Dhaulagiri mountains of Himalayas, right? But never in their life they had seen those mountains because there's so much of pollution. People who are elders, 70, 80 years, they are mentioning, we used to see when we were small children, but now after some time we didn't see because of pollution. But now pollution is gone, clear sky, they are seeing the mountains. So nature is also, we also saw many posters where peacocks are seen in South Mumbai. One devotee was who stays in South Mumbai next to the ocean. He saw occasionally dolphins jumping from the ocean. So many people are appreciating, lockdown is helping, lockdown is helping. The nature is put a reset button. People are appreciating, now we have got time with the family. People are appreciating, we can appreciate the gifts which we have got. So this appreciation is there, right? So people are started contemplating in their life, right? Many people are contemplating to become now non-violent, take to vegetarianism. So all those things are there. But if the association of devotees is not there for them, matter of time, as soon as lockdown is over, everyone is going to forget. Delete all those videos from their files. Maybe keep in memory, you know, those days, 21 days or 31 days, whatever it may be, or those few months, whatever it may be. Sushan Vairagya. However, devotees like us, who are practicing Krishna consciousness, it is time also to rethink and to analyze our situation in our life. That are we really staying in an illusion within Krishna consciousness, making our own bubble? So now this coronavirus has helped us to burst that bubble out and make us think that how temporary life is. And we are planning ahead of time. People are planning for months together. I'll do this, I'll do that. Now they can't plan. They even don't know what to do now. Plan for tomorrow, plan for next month, next year. No one is planning at all. So this is an example why Krishna is bursting the bubble of illusion. So that we can understand whatever practice of Krishna consciousness we have done, whatever we have heard, it's time to contemplate for all of us. And we understand that how Krishna is ultimately our shelter, our ashray, and that If we take shelter of Krishna, then as Srivast Thakur got in the crisis, double benefit. In this crisis, when we take shelter of Krishna, 100%. This crisis, after this crisis, every devotee, if they take proper advantage, they will come out with some amazing realizations in Krishna consciousness, provided we take each other's association with social distance and take advantage of this important event which is happening all over the world, and also time to preach to others. Thank you so much. Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Granthra Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai. Hare Krishna.